is a breaking news alert from 7 Action News.
Breaking news this morning. The jury has reached a verdict in the Kwame Kilpatrick corruption trial. We want to get right to 7 Action News investigator Heather Catalo, who is downtown outside the federal courthouse. Heather, what can you tell us?
Well, Anu, as you know, the jury has been deliberating for 14 days, and now first thing Monday morning, they come in and they let the judge know that they do have a verdict in this historic trial. Of course, as you know, there has been 5 months of testimony, 91 different witnesses, so many of those government agents that told so many stories of the evidence that they brought in of what they say was corruption, that City Hall in this town was for sale.
Again, a jury has reached a verdict in the Kwame Kilpatrick federal corruption trial. He, along with his father, Bernard Kilpatrick, as well as friend Bobby Ferguson, all accused of running a criminal enterprise. Heather, I want to stay with you for a little bit longer. Can you talk to us a little bit more about these charges? Again, 33 counts, correct, that they've decided on?
Absolutely. Of course, count number one, which will be the first one read, my understanding is the big racketeering charge. And of course, it'll be very interesting to see what the jury decides on that and whether that count will then have an impact on the rest of the counts, because count number one encompasses 26 different alleged different called predicate acts, essentially kind of 26 different crimes within that count. The jury has to decide on two of those acts. If they unanimously agree that on two of those things, these three men agreed to commit these acts, then you have RICO. They could be found guilty on RICO. Then the rest of the charges are bribery and extortion charges. Now, a lot of the extortion and attempted extortion charges are in line with what the acts are within RICO.
These are live pictures right now of Kwame Kilpatrick leaving, I believe it's his mother's house.
Can you talk to us just for a moment?
We're trying to get a word from Kwame Kilpatrick right now. Kwame, can you tell us how you're feeling?
Just your thoughts for today.
Please.
Just your thoughts on the day.
He's not having anything to say. Our photographer has been out here since 8 o'clock. There was absolutely no movement in the house at all. This is the home of Carolyn Cheeks Kilpatrick, former U.S. Congresswoman, Kwame Kilpatrick's mother. This is where he's been staying for the last several weeks on a tether for violating his state parole. And we were wondering if he had gotten out early this morning, but just a few minutes ago, this white car pulled up, honked the horn. Mr. Kilpatrick, as you saw, came out the front door, and he is now heading down to the federal courthouse.
Again, the verdict is going to be read in 25 minutes, but we do want to remind our viewers that unlike many cases where you can have a camera in the courtroom and so you see that jury being read, in federal court that is not allowed at all. We can't even get the audio of the verdict being read. So we're going to be getting it on what we call our verdict live blog that you can follow along. You're going to see this come in literally as we see it come in. It's there's going to be a computer screen that we have up, and they'll be checking off guilty, not guilty for each of the counts. So that will happen, it's estimated, in about 24 minutes from right now.
We're getting it right here.
Guilty. We have guilty. This is the first count now. This is the racketeering count. Kwame Kilpatrick, guilty. Bobby Ferguson, guilty of the racketeering conspiracy count. And Bernard Kilpatrick, a hung jury on that first count. So there is one of the counts they could not agree on. Let's go to count two. This is extortion now. This is regarding a sewer lining contract. Again, Kwame Kilpatrick, guilty of count two of extortion. Bobby Ferguson was also charged in this count as well, and he also is guilty. This is count two of extortion. Already right there, two guilty verdicts, up to 20 years in prison, a loss for the defense, at least on the first two verdicts so far.
And now we're looking at count three, extortion here, amendment to the sewer lining contract. And of course, you could read there, if found guilty on count three, the defendants could face up to 20 years in prison. Guilty for Kwame Kilpatrick on count three, extortion.
And Bobby Ferguson, guilty as well.
Count nine will be guilty. This is guilty once again for former mayor of Detroit, Kwame Kilpatrick. And count nine, extortion, repair of East Side water main.
This is a stunning, stunning victory for the prosecution. Most all guilty verdicts at this point, with a couple of hung jury counts for Kwame Kilpatrick and one for Bernard Kilpatrick.
Well, we are live outside federal court here, Joanne. Good afternoon. It was quite a scene. Kwame Kilpatrick staring at the jurors before the verdict was read, as Judge Nancy Edmonds was thanking them, almost looked like he was near tears. Then the verdict was read, and he simply looked down at his notes and took notes, as his lawyer did as well. Did not show much emotion, but no question, this is a big win for the feds, at least as it relates to Bobby Ferguson and Kwame Kilpatrick, and Kwame Kilpatrick's father, Bernard Kilpatrick, essentially, I would say, has had a good day. He only got that one tax charge, which carries up to 3 years, but he was found not guilty on some counts, and there there was no verdict rendered on the big RICO charge. So
now you know that there will be a bunch of agents and analysts delving into where did all the money go and can we get any of it back for the government.
All right, we have that statement from Mayor Bing's office. I'll send it over to you, Jeff and Joanne, to deliver that to us.
Yeah, thank you. We just got this. Mayor Bing said today, I am pleased that this long trial has ended and we can finally put this negative chapter in Detroit's history behind us. It is time for all of us to move forward with a renewed commitment to transparency and high ethical standards in our city government. That was Mayor Dave Bing responding to the outcome today. 24 guilty verdicts for Kwame Kilpatrick, 9 for Bobby Ferguson, 1 for Bernard Kilpatrick.
Let's go live to Scott, yeah.
And we are following breaking news right now on the Kilpatrick corruption trial verdict for you. We have been live all morning long on air and on our website at WXYZ.com.
That's right. I'm Jeff Vaughn. This is Joanne Pertmer, joined by Tom Kramer, legal expert, along with Chuck Stokes, editorial director here at WXYZ. It's been a very, very busy morning. Let's go straight now to downtown to 7 Action News investigator Heather Catala, which has been following this story from the very beginning. Heather, good morning.
Good morning. And Jeff, of course, this is such a stunning day. Kwame Kilpatrick guilty on 24 different charges, including racketeering conspiracy, the almighty RICO charge, guilty. Bobby Ferguson guilty on that one as well. Both guilty on extortion charges. Bernard Kilpatrick, the jury did not find him to be part of that racketeering, part of that RICO charge. I'm sure his attorney is counting this as a victory. Only one tax charge of guilty for Bernard Kilpatrick, which honestly is not that surprising considering the way some of the evidence came in. There was definitely some question about the level of Bernard Kilpatrick's involvement with certain things, or at least what some of the evidence that they were able to show. So it was quite a zoo down here earlier as the defendants were leaving federal court. Things have calmed down because that jury is talking and a lot of the attorneys are still inside the building. I believe they've moved to some of the overflow rooms and they're listening to the jury answer the questions from the reporters. I don't believe the federal prosecutors have come out either, so I suspect they're listening as well. Of course, there's still many more people we'd like to speak to about this stunning verdict today, and hopefully as they make their way out of federal court, we'll be able to ask some questions. But a huge, huge victory for the government. Guilty Kwame Kilpatrick, guilty Bobby Ferguson, 24 and 9 counts respectively. Bernard Kilpatrick guilty on a tax charge. Back to you.
What do you have for us, Heather?
Okay, Mike Ratzai, one of Bobby Ferguson's lawyers, is joining me live. Mike, just your gut reaction to today's verdict.
Well, obviously, we're disappointed, to say the least, Heather. I was surprised by the verdict. I thought for sure that we had established reasonable doubt on the RICO counts and the other substantive counts of bribery and extortion. But, you know, it is what it is.
What do you make of your client having been the one that was wiretapped, and yet they could not come to a decision on the biggest charge of all for him?
Boy, it's a good question, Heather, and I haven't thought about it.
Thank you very much. John Shea talking to us live about the decision here in court today. His client faring the best of all of them, and obviously still a lot of shock, a lot for these attorneys to take in with today's verdict. It looks like Mr. Ferguson and his legal team, if we want to turn over here, they're coming back in to go back up for the detention hearing. They're on their way back into court. Mr. Ferguson, how are you doing, Mr. Ferguson?
I'm great. God is good. It's all in God's hand.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Ferguson. Mr. Ferguson saying again, God is good. As his attorneys have told us many times throughout this trial, he's a very spiritual man, as I was talking about earlier today. He would often read a prayer book before testimony would begin for each day. So they're heading back into the federal court to have this hearing on whether or not they'll be remanded back into federal custody. It'll be very interesting to see what the judge decides. We'll know that answer shortly. Back to you.
Breaking news. Detention is required in his circumstance, Edmund says. Kilpatrick and Ferguson will be remanded for detention. They're going behind bars. That is the breaking news just now from the courtroom. The judge has remanded both of these gentlemen to custody while they await sentencing.
A marshal just approached Kilpatrick, presumably to take him into custody. So this has got to be an emotional day. I know we don't have cameras in that bond hearing, but with his mother sitting right behind him, I would imagine, and all of those family members, that it's got to be an emotional time right now.
Absolutely. The other shoe drop, that's what's happened here, was the conviction and the shock of that for them. And then now that their freedom is gone.
I was struck by the poignant moment that after Judge Nancy Edmonds ruled that they would be detained, she called it a close call. Kwame Kilpatrick had to take off his sport coat, his cufflinks, his belt, his watch, empty his pockets, and hand all of that to his family members. The same with Bobby Ferguson. He had to dress down to basically his clothes. And then as Kilpatrick was leaving court, handcuffed with his arms behind his back, he said, be strong, take it easy. Someone from the family hollered back to him, love ya. And then he turned around. The last things he said as he walked out the door, walking out of court, he said, no doubt, no fear. Someone from the family hollered back, none. What a poignant moment in today where he walked in strong this morning before these verdicts. He walked out in handcuffs.
Chopper 7 live over the scene of the Milan Federal Correctional Facility where Kilpatrick and Bobby Ferguson have just arrived. And the two are facing lengthy prison sentences for running a criminal enterprise out of the mayor's office.
One juror today saying what she saw in court turned her stomach. We've got a breakdown for you now of the verdict. Kwame Kilpatrick found guilty on 24 counts, including racketeering, extortion, bribery, and fraud.
Contractor Bobby Ferguson was found guilty on 9 counts of racketeering and extortion. Bernard Kilpatrick was only found guilty on 1 count, a tax charge. We have Team 7 coverage on every angle of this verdict tonight, from the defendants to the prosecution to the jury and Detroiters as well. We begin tonight with 7 Action News investigator Heather Catalo, who has been following this case from the very beginning. Heather, a very epic day at the end of a very long trial.
Absolutely. This was a history-making day here at federal court. As you said, Kwame Kilpatrick and Bobby Ferguson both convicted of the racketeering and the extortion charges, the most serious charges in this case. The jury was hung on whether or not Bernard Kilpatrick was part of that Kilpatrick enterprise. And Ferguson and Kilpatrick are already in federal custody. Inside the courtroom, Detroit's former mayor and his friend Bobby Ferguson listened as the jury read charge after charge of guilty convictions for the two men. Kwame Kilpatrick and Bobby Ferguson, both guilty of the racketeering count. The jury sending a clear message that they ran a criminal enterprise out of City Hall. Both men were convicted of several extortion charges related to city water department contracts, as well as a bribery charge for a $75,000 payment Ferguson made to the Kilpatrick Civic Fund. The former mayor was also convicted of several mail and wire fraud charges, as well as all 6 tax charges. Kilpatrick said nothing as he left federal court after the verdict.
He's pensive. He's under the circumstances, he's doing as good as he can.
I was surprised by the verdict. I thought for sure that we had established reasonable doubt on the RICO counts and the other substantive counts of bribery and extortion.
Again, the jury was hung on whether or not Bernard Kilpatrick was part of the Kilpatrick enterprise on that RICO charge. And the U.S. attorney has announced that she will not be retrying him on that count. That means Bernard Kilpatrick, who was facing 4 different charges, some of them with penalties up to 20 years, is now only convicted of 1 tax crime with a penalty of up to 3 years. So even though his attorney told me today that, of course, Bernard Kilpatrick is just absolutely devastated about what has happened to his son, in a way, it was a bit of a victory for Bernard Kilpatrick and his legal team today. Now, just to walk everybody back through in case you weren't with us all day, after the verdict was read, the defendants were allowed to leave the court, but then they came back in for another hearing up on the 8th floor up there. That's where the judge decided to remand them back into federal custody, and it was during that hearing that Kwame Kilpatrick finally showed the emotion he obviously wasn't showing for the duration of this trial. He just looked sick. He kept covering his eyes, covering his ears, just the emotion of where his life is now headed. It obviously was hitting him. He looked absolutely devastated. Our reporters in the courtroom say they'd never seen him like that before, ever. He's now facing potentially decades behind bars.
You're watching 7 Action News, always taking action for you.
The Kilpatrick corruption case.
Is there a reason you only wiretapped Bernard?
An FBI agent is taking us inside the investigation.
You saw it first on 7 last night. Now,
are you done with Kwame Kilpatrick?
We find out what happened behind the scenes in the courtroom.
The lead FBI agent in the Kilpatrick corruption case answering our questions about the historic investigation.
Tonight, new insight about on in the and whether the feds are done with Detroit's former mayor. 7 Action News investigator Heather Catalo joins us now. And Heather, normally FBI agents really don't like to talk to reporters. So how did you end up getting them to talk.
Well, I asked the FBI if Special Agent Bob Beckman would be willing to talk to us about what it was like to put this case together. And he agreed to speak on behalf of his team, in part because legally they've had to stay silent for so long, but mainly because he really wants everyone to know that the FBI cannot pursue cases like this without the public's help.
35 convictions in the City Hall corruption probe, and the feds finally snared the biggest fish of all, Detroit's former mayor, convicted of running a criminal enterprise out of City Hall. The case against Kwame Kilpatrick, his friend Bobby Ferguson, and his father Bernard Kilpatrick took nearly a decade to build, and FBI Special Agent Bob Beckman was the lead case agent at the center of the investigation from day one.
What was your first sense that something was amiss in the Kilpatrick administration?
Well, we had a number of different people who had given us information. There were sources that ranged from things like maybe another agent would have a case and there'd be a defendant that would cooperate, provide some information. Or someone would call with a complaint, or maybe another contractor would make a complaint and that sort of thing.
Special Agent Beckman has a passion for fighting public corruption, and going after the bad guys is in his blood. His father was a police officer, and before joining the FBI 17 years ago, Beckman worked as a prosecutor in Saginaw County.
If people engage in self-dealing and bribery and extortion like that, those kind of cases have ramifications far beyond Southeast Michigan. We don't want to be known for that kind of behavior.
Agent Beckman, the assistant U.S. attorneys, and his case partners at the EPA and IRS have worked nonstop for months preparing for the historic five-month-long corruption trial, a trial with 91 witnesses, about 1,000 exhibits, and all those text messages.
What was your biggest fear during the trial?
I had several fears. I had your fear as a case agent is that you're going to have an empty witness chair and a witness hadn't shown up. You're going to have 12 people sitting there expecting you to present something and have nothing. So what we did in this case was double and triple and quadruple book. And so the witnesses that you saw on the witness stand, in some cases, had been sitting there in our waiting room for about 5 days. I guess the ultimate fear is that perhaps a jury might not find it persuasive and your work might not result in any convictions, but as we know, that didn't happen.
Did you have a moment where you were really worried?
I really didn't. I felt very confident in the evidence, and as did all my law enforcement partners.
Are you done with Kwame Kilpatrick?
Well, I'm going to sit back and watch the sentencing like everybody else. That's am I done with Kwame Kilpatrick? Well, I think a RICO indictment and conviction, that speaks for itself. That ought to be the end of the line, unless, as an FBI agent, you never say, hey, I'm done investigating, because somebody could call me tomorrow with a hot tip and we would act on that.
It wasn't always easy getting witnesses to cooperate. In fact, it wasn't until Kwame Kilpatrick was out of office that the investigation really took off. And Special Agent Beckman says he can't stop corruption if the anti-snitch mentality in this region continues.
You can't assume that the FBI is just going to tap everyone's telephone and indict people. The way we tap people's telephones, if indeed we do go that route, is because we've talked to folks who've given us information that we put into an affidavit and we get a court order, okay? All those things take the cooperation of the people in Southeast Michigan. And without that, we have nothing. There is no case that's ever gonna be brought against a public official if people don't pick up the telephone and call the FBI.
If you do have a crime to report, their phone number is 313-965-2323. And during our interview, Agent Beckman could not stress enough how much of a team they had. At one point, there were about 70 agents working on the case, not to mention all of the people at the U.S. Attorney's Office who were part of the investigation from the start. Just a colossal effort.
The Kilpatrick corruption case would have never even gone to trial if it hadn't been for a group of citizens, the grand jury, who indicted him. 7 Action News investigator Heather Cataldo takes us inside a system that's cloaked in secrecy, but has changed the shape of Detroit's political landscape.
23 people, regular people like you and me, serving on a grand jury. They come together in secret inside this room, and their decisions can shape a life, a city, or even a nation.
Before a verdict, Kwame Kilpatrick guilty on 24 different charges, including racketeering conspiracy. Before a trial.
Did Mr. Cato give you cash?
The massive corruption case against Kwame Kilpatrick started behind these closed doors. A federal grand jury spent 2.5 years sitting in these chairs, listening to hundreds of witnesses and examining mountains of evidence. The grand jury system is completely secret, and it's a vital step in a federal criminal case.
Instead of a prosecutor filing charges against someone like in state court, here inside this building, the federal district court, a panel of 23 citizens makes that crucial first decision on whether to charge someone with a felony.
You have someone's life in your hands, and you had better make sure.
Jill recently served on a grand jury in Detroit. Because of grand jury secrecy laws, she can't tell us which cases she heard. Jill says when she got that summons in the mail, she had no idea that she was about to play such a key role in democracy.
My first thing was, how do I get out of this? I don't want to commit myself to something else, but I am so glad I was chosen to do it.
Unlike a trial jury, which usually reports for duty every day, grand jurors typically meet once a week for 18 months.
The prosecutors are over here, and the witness is over here.
U.S. District Court Chief Judge Gerald Rosen took us inside a grand jury room where so many of Detroit's high-profile cases started.
You'll notice there's no table for defense counsel because defense counsel are not permitted in the grand jury room. It's strictly a proceeding in which the government presents evidence to the citizenry.
The foreperson and deputy foreperson sit in the front of the room while the rest of the grand jurors fill these seats. They are not determining guilt or innocence. Their only job is to see if there's enough probable cause for an indictment.
The grand jury process reflects who we are as a people and our values. It reflects, going back to the revolution, our distrust of government overreaching.
What do you think is the biggest misconception about the grand jury system?
I think the biggest misconception is that the grand jury is just a rubber stamp for the prosecution.
Defense lawyers say grand juries only hear one side of the story because there's no chance at all for the targets of the investigation to present their own evidence.
What people don't see along the way is the involvement of the grand jury in the process itself, bringing in more witnesses, not charging on some charges that the government is urging.
Judge Rosen says when a grand jury uncovers more misconduct, they can direct federal agents and prosecutors to keep investigating. That's why the term of the Detroit corruption case special grand jury was extended 2 times for a total of 2.5 years.
I was so humbled when I discharged them. I heard story after story after story about how, although there were hardships for them and for their family, that they believed that they had to see this through, that it was the most important thing they had done.
Usually, just the foreperson returns the indictment to a magistrate, but Judge Rosen says the Kilpatrick corruption grand jurors were so committed, all 23 of them went into the courtroom to hand down the indictment against the former mayor and his co-defendants.
Because they wanted to show how unified they were and how committed they were to their product. Very unusual. I don't know of any other time when that's happened.
Judge Rosen says the citizens of this region should be very grateful for the work those grand jurors did. As for this grand juror, she's just grateful she was chosen to make a difference.
We have the power to change things.
The judge says grand juries have to stay secret in order to protect both witnesses and potential targets of an investigation. If a grand jury decides there isn't enough evidence to charge someone, making the investigation public could have terrible consequences on someone's reputation. I'm Heather Cataldo, 7 Action News. Inside the courtroom, it was a very dramatic day. The judge said it was the citizens of Detroit who suffered when they handed over their hard-earned tax dollars and got corruption in return. And now Kwame Kilpatrick is going to pay for that.
28 years behind bars for Detroit's disgraced former mayor who once promised a comeback. Judge Nancy Edmonds said she could have given Kwame Kilpatrick a life sentence for his sweeping corruption in public office. But instead, she limited his sentence to nearly three decades for his convictions on racketeering, bribery, extortion, mail and wire fraud, and tax crimes. Kilpatrick cried several times as he quietly told the judge he was sorry for letting so many people down, but he still would not admit that he stole from the city. Judge Edmonds sent a powerful message to public officials, saying they must be accountable to the citizens.
She said, this is a new time. It's accountability and transparency in government. It was important. I think that's what drove her decision today.
The judge said it was hard to quantify the cost of the, quote, corrosive pay-to-play system that Kilpatrick put into motion in the city. Instead of realizing his potential, the judge said he abused the public trust by choosing personal enrichment over integrity. Kilpatrick's attorney called the 28-year sentence excessive for a nonviolent conviction and said it was hard to see Kilpatrick break down in tears.
It was an emotional time. It would be for anybody in that circumstance. It was an emotional time for me, and I'm there as a lawyer, and not as the person who was sentenced.
Kilpatrick will now be separated from his family for decades. Meanwhile, the federal agents and prosecutors who spent countless hours investigating the former mayor and the 34 other people convicted in the City Hall corruption probe say they can now finally spend some time with their loved ones after years of sacrifice.
Well, we're just happy to go back and go to our kids' soccer games and actually start living a normal life again.
Absolutely. I mean, we were talking about that there are parts of 2012 that we just kind of don't remember it actually happening with our family. So it's been a tremendous sacrifice, but not just for us, for everybody on the team, the agents, the everyone. And it really has been a team effort. So we commend our team.
So here's the breakdown of how the judge handled the sentence. Kilpatrick got 20 years for the RICO and extortion conviction. She gave him 7 years for all of the mail and wire fraud convictions. And then he got an additional year for the tax convictions. That, of course, brings the total up to 28 years in prison. Kilpatrick is still in custody right now, and his attorney does plan to appeal this. Reporting live at the federal courthouse in downtown Detroit, I'm Heather Cataldo, 7 Action News.